Well, again, welcome. It's an honor to have you here today and a privilege to have you here today. And I mean that honestly. So thank you. Thank you so much for being here. And we're in our seventh week of our series called Grave Robber. And we're basing this off of Mark Batterson's book called The Grave Robber. And if you hadn't got a copy of this book, you need to get a copy because I'm not teaching you the book. I'm just looking at his scripture and then building sermons off of that. I've got a few quotes each week from him that I think are very important. But this book is just full of miraculous. You just need to know that God loves you and God's in the miracle business. He's in the miracle business. And what we're looking at and what Mark does is we're looking at the incredible power of Jesus as displayed in seven miraculous signs or miracles that John chooses to record in his book. And John puts them in there for a very specific purpose to let you know that those signs and miracles were not just something he wanted to do 2,000 years ago. He does them today. And a lot of us miss our miracles. And so we want to be on top of this thing. And John chooses to call them signs because that's exactly what they are. They're like signposts that are pointing people past the actual miracle to the power behind the miracle, which is God. And that's what we need to focus on, is that right there. So, the power of God is behind all of these miracles and these signs. And so far, just like the bumper was showing you, we've seen Jesus act as a winemaker at the wedding, the choreographer, how he creates that gospel dance and puts people in the right place at the right time. This weekend is SOS week, Society of Stranders, if you don't know what that is. That's a bunch of shag people. And they go down there and they do this shag, and I've been watching. I've got several friends whose children are in the junior division, and I'm telling you what, they got moves in their feet that I can't move my body any way like that, and their feet are doing all that kind of stuff. Just amazing. Dennis and Debbie Brown who attend here. Caleb. Caleb's a national champion shagger. And so that choreography, that how that just so smoothly goes together in the gospel dance we talked about. We saw Jesus is a rule breaker. He's prone to break a few rules now and then. And then also we saw him as Lord Algebra, how he took a happy meal and fed 20,000 people with it. And you're saying, wait a minute, Scott, that's wrong because the scripture says 5,000. That's 5,000 men of military age. So there were probably 20,000 people all total, counting grandma and the kids and everybody, you know. So last week we looked at Jesus being the water walker and all the miracles that were around that. I mean, there's just tons of miracles even in that one sign there. And today we're going to look at Jesus being the eye opener. And what we've done each week is just to help give you some historical background and some cultural background. That's what we're going to do first. So let's look at the place. Where did this take place? Probably two or three series ago, we talked about where Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And remember, he did that. He said that at the Feast of the Tabernacles in Jerusalem, where the Feast of the Tabernacles, or shelters, depending on what your translation says, that commemorates that pillar of fire that guided the Jewish people all the way from Egypt into the Promised Land. And if you remember, the temple court was set up with huge, giant candelabras that historians said would even light all of Jerusalem. And so Jesus said, right when they put those out on the last day of the thing and it went completely dark in the temple, Jesus took the opportunity to say, I am the light of the world. So that has just happened. That has literally just happened. And as chapter 8 closes up in the book of John, John paints this picture of this crisis where the Jews are ready to stone Jesus, but Jesus gets away from them and finds himself in what I call the shadow of the steeple, right outside the temple. Okay? And right outside the temple is a skid row where all the, you know, where all the beggars hung out and all that kind of thing. Everybody who couldn't do anything hung out there. And guys, this is the perfect setting for the next sign that Jesus performs, the next miracle that he performs. And I like to think there's three, I've broken it down into three different encounters that take place during this one particular sign. So if you've got your Bibles, turn them on or open them up to John 9. And if you have a YouVersion Bible app, which I'd encourage you to get, you can go on there and log on the live event, and then it will say Outbreak Church, and all the sermon notes, everything will pop up right there for you, and you can actually take your own notes and everything right there. If you need it, the Outbreak login for the internet is Be Contagious, all lowercase. Be Contagious, all lowercase. Okay? So, but we're looking at John 9, and I'm reading from the Holman Christian Standard. And let's look at these three different encounters. And the first encounter I want us to look at is the encounter between the disciples and the blind man. Might be a little different from what you think. Okay? And I titled this one, The Inconsideration. Okay? They're just inconsiderate. So, let's pick this up. Jesus leaves the temple. And that was the hub of Christian religious life there, and it had finished that massive ceremony and feast, and there's all these dignified and proud and righteous religious people who were just rejecting him, and they want to kill him. So it can't be any more of a contrast there, and by all accounts that we've seen in the Bible, Jesus comes across this guy that basically deserves nothing. This guy's just there in the midst of a sea of beggars, I'm sure. He deserves nothing, but what he gets is grace. You and I don't deserve a thing, but what Jesus gives us is grace. And I'm just going to say this too. A lot of times we think about grace as being only that what God extends to us. You realize he extends that to us so we can offer to other people. Those people you want to slap their face, instead give them grace. I made it rhyme. Can you get it? I'm a rap artist. I love it. I love my hip hop. When you want to slap their face, just give them grace. And I can see Jesse right now, even all the way in Hartsville, saying, Daddy, please don't do that again. Please don't do that again. Please don't do that again. But that's, and see, we have to, when you understand what grace is and when you understand what the gospel is, that affects every part of your life. It affects how you relate to your boss, your husband, your ex, your future, your grandchildren, your children, everybody. Everybody. So this guy deserved nothing, and chances are the people you are dealing with deserve nothing other than a black eye you ought to give them, but you need to give them grace. And the great thing about this is, or the interesting thing I should say, the ironic thing, is it's the very grace is what offends all these religious people. You know what? Don't tell anybody. It still does today. How many years have we been religious and never understood grace? How many churches are preaching religion and not grace? Well-meaning churches, well-meaning pastors, I've sat under for years. You've sat under for years. Guys, that's a travesty. That is a travesty. We've been known and prone to teach a gospel of sin management. If you just manage your sin, you'll be okay. Guys, that's not right. You don't have to manage your sin because God has managed it for you through the power of the Holy Spirit and what he did on the cross for you. You are seen as righteous as the sun rises. The S-O-N rises. And that's the whole core. That is the whole core of salvation. is it's grace. It's not merited. We don't deserve it. We can't earn it. We can't buy it. We can't be good enough. We can't go on enough mission trips. We can't give enough to the church. We can't do any of that stuff. It's only Jesus. And Jesus only. And listen, whenever you add anything to Jesus, you are negating Jesus. If you add baptism, now we baptized last week, and baptism is, we believe in baptism, that's an outward symbol, but some people will tell you that baptism, that you have to be baptized to be a Christian. And you don't. Okay? You don't. So if you add anything to Christ, you're negating Christ. It's totally unmerited. It's grace. So let's pick this up. Look at verse 1 there. And we're going to sort of split this up just a little bit. Look at verse 1. As he was passing by, he saw a blind man from birth. Say from birth. From when? Okay. Right. From birth. Right. He didn't have an accident and go blind. He was blind from birth. This guy has never seen in his whole life. You with me? Okay. Well, that's important. We need to understand that. In ancient cultures, and quite frankly, in modern cultures, blind people have no other choice other than to be beggars or rely on just handouts and that kind of thing, okay? Chances are this guy was very poor and was begging along the roadside there by the temple when Jesus walked by. I just want to tell you, I cannot imagine losing the ability to see. I can't even grasp that. One minute you're seeing everything, and the next minute you're in complete darkness. I don't even want to imagine that. But here we're introduced to a man who has been blind since birth. The only thing he has ever known is darkness. I'm going to let that hang right there just a second. Let's try an experiment here. Close your eyes. Everybody do it. Everybody do it. Now don't go sleep on me. Okay? Close your eyes. Okay? Imagine an apple. You see it? Okay? Now, imagine your favorite beach. Okay? Your world is dark, but you can still imagine pictures that you have seen in the past, right? Okay, open your eyes. So what happens is your brain, you know, people say, I've got a photographic memory. All of us have a photographic memory to some extent. And your brain locks in those images and you just recall them even though you were in the dark, right? Okay. You were recalling pictures you had seen from your past. You got to understand, this guy had never seen an apple. This guy had never seen a face. He basically had never seen a person. He'd never seen any, he was totally blind. Totally blind. Lived his whole life in darkness. This was the only world this guy had ever known. And that's important for us to understand. So, look at what the disciples said. Like I said, this is the inconsideration. This is where the inconsiderate part comes in. His disciples questioned him. Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? So immediately what they're doing, don't we all have a tendency to... We have a tendency not to see those people who are disabled, and we trivialize them or their disadvantage or whatever you want to call that. And then in one of the instances is blind people are often treated like they can't hear. I find myself doing that too. If I had a blind friend at Furman, and he told me one time, he said, Scott, I'm not deaf. I'm blind. I just can't see. I can hear you real good, so quit hollering at me. I thought, okay. Isn't that what we do? We treat blind people like they can't we treat them like they can't hear, okay? And that's exactly what the disciples, there's a blind guy here. And so the disciples are like, and this guy's been there forever. Think about the just the discouragement they laid on this guy. He's there. He's been blind all his life. And they say, so Jesus, what's this dude's problem? Was it him that sinned or was it his parents? Man, you're talking about a buzzkill and busting his bubble. That was it. It's exactly what they did here. And I want to tell you, that question, now these guys were the disciples. They had lived with Jesus. They had smelled Jesus' BO. They had eaten fish with him. They had done everything with him. And yet, do you realize how legalistic that question is? That is a total legalistic outlook on life. And it's an outlook that is still to this day fostered by religious people. Legalism in itself is an attempt to earn God's favor through what you do. Okay? You're doing good stuff to get God's favor. And a legalist, and I'm reading out of my systematic theology book here. A legalist operates under the usually unspoken assumption that people earn or keep God's favor through righteous deeds. So legalists, listen, legalists begin to view themselves as deserving of certain things. I'm afraid, folks, that we grew up an entire generation of entitled Christians. Well, I deserve it. I deserve that. I deserve this. In other words, here's the way it rolls. If I can earn God's favor by doing good stuff, then the more good stuff I do, listen, the more indebted God becomes to me. Shut up. You children here, I know it's not polite to say shut up. That was a polite expletive. Okay? Did you hear what I said? A legalist believes that the more good stuff they do, the more God is indebted to them. God must reward my good deeds with blessings, and if something bad happens, it's because I've been bad, and if something good happens, it's because I've been good. And the disciples looked at this guy born blind, and they said, okay, it's either his parents or him. Who is it, Jesus? And Jesus ain't got no sympathy for no legalism. He didn't then. He don't now. There are people who are right, and I'm just going to say it. It might be you. If it is, I'm not going to apologize because somebody needs to be the Simon Cowell in your life and set you straight. You know who Simon Cowell is? Okay, that's the guy on American Idol when they used to have it. Some poor girl or boy whose grandmama told him they was the best singer in the world comes on there, and Simon Cowell says, I don't know who your grandmama is, but she a lie because you can't sing, you know? There are people who are riding their spiritual, legalistic high horses all the way to church today. And they're parking them in their spiritual, legalistic parking places, and they're getting out and coming into their spiritual, legalistic, entitled seats in their church, and you better not sit in them or you're going straight to hell. I served a church one time where a lady tried, she came three times to church. Every time she came on a different Sunday, she went to sit down and some person came and told her she was sitting in her seat. So she came back and she said, that's a mighty big church. And I didn't know they had reserved seating. She never came back again. I'm going to tell you what. Y'all look at your seat right now. Just look at it. Your name on there?
No.
I'll tell you what's on there.
Martha's not
cheap. I'll tell you what's on there where we bought them. Cheap church chairs. So if that's your name, then you got a seat. But if it ain't, you drop it where you can. Okay? I'm just saying. Okay? But listen, this guy, let's get back to the story. I done gone to meddling in people's lives now. Lord, help me. All right. This, listen, this blindness has nothing to do with his sin. Your failing marriage has, well, it might have something to do with somebody's sin, but, you know, it's not based on God running your, you know, running his thumb in you because you did something wrong. Okay? This guy's blindness had nothing to do with sin. Now, granted, birth defects and disease and all that kind of stuff came about when Adam and Eve created that situation and the earth fell and everything fell. We understand that, okay? But here's what you got to understand. This guy's blindness had nothing to do with his sin or his mama's sin. It's his blindness was there for a bigger purpose. This guy was born blind so that Jesus could come along and teach a profound truth about spiritual blindness and show himself as the light of the world. That puts a whole different perspective on your trials, doesn't it? Usually this is what happens when I run into a trial, and I'll just be honest with you, I start doing this legalism thing. God, how could you allow that to happen to me? Let me ask you this. Why is it that we never mention God's name until something goes wrong and he's the first person we blame? I know people who are atheists who have told me it's God's fault. And I just had to laugh in the midst of their cry. I said, there ain't no God, remember? It can't be his fault, according to you. That's exactly what happens. We give God four-letter last names and everything else, and then when something happens, we blame it on him. But that's human nature, and we always look for somebody to blame. Adam and Eve did it, we did it, you know. I did it when I was growing up, you did it when you was growing up, I do it as an adult, you do it as an adult, it's just what we do. So, God, how could you allow this to happen? Haven't you noticed everything I'm doing for you, God? Haven't you seen that? And then my next response is usually, how quickly are you going to get me out of this, God? How fast is this going to stop? All the time, I'm missing the fact, the bigger purpose, that the fact that God has a much bigger purpose in life. And here's the thing, and I just want to share this with you. To short-circuit that trial might mean that you might miss out on a huge display of God's glory. Listen to what Mark Batterson says. I know you've heard this before. Mark Batterson says in the book, at some point, we must recognize that the circumstances we ask God to change are often the very circumstances God is using to change us. So the disciples were thinking about what caused this guy's blindness, and Jesus shifted their attention from the cause to the purpose. Look at the next verse there, verse 3. Neither this man nor his parents sinned, Jesus said. This came about so that God's works might be displayed in him. Now, here's what you need to understand right off the bat. This doesn't mean that God sort of unmercifully picked this guy out and said, before he was a twinkle in his daddy's eye, he was like, okay, that kid's going to be blind and it, you know, it's kind of like, eh. He didn't do that. God just let nature take its course to prove a point, okay, that would ultimately bring glory to God through that point. And it would also bring about physical sight and spiritual sight. Now, you know as well as I do, and we've all experienced this, that in a lot of cultures, especially Jewish culture, most people believe that any calamity or thing that happened to you or suffering resulted from sin. Remember Job, some of his well-meaning friends who sat there and burned his ears off, you know, all those times, were saying, well, what'd you do, man? What'd you do to cause all this? Okay? So they thought everything happened bad because of sin, but this guy suffered so that God could be glorified. And, you know, we live in a fallen world where good behavior is not always rewarded and bad behavior is not always punished. And unfortunately, innocent people suffer sometimes. A lot of times it's no fault. But think about this. If God took away all the suffering whenever we asked, Would you follow him for comfort and convenience, or would you be following him for love and devotion? A lot of people today are following Jesus just because it's convenient and they're wanting this, that, and the other. Are you going to follow him? Remember, you know that song that's on the radio a lot of times, Even If? Even if he doesn't do this, am I still going to follow him? Even if. And then Jesus throws this little section in here just to talk about how he's trying to tell the disciples, look, it's important that we get on with our business here because there's stuff that has to be done in the kingdom. So he throws this in. He says, we must do the works of him who sent me while it's day. Night is coming. Now notice he's talking about dark and light there. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am the light, I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. So that was their in consideration of him. They talked about him and thinking he couldn't hear. They just automatically made a false assumption that he sinned or somebody sinned. So that was the in consideration. Now, look at the next part. The next interaction here is between Jesus and the blind man. And I call this the demonstration, okay? Because Jesus is going to demonstrate his power in an incredible way. So, verse 6. After he said these things, he spit on the ground, made some mud from the saliva, and spread mud on his eyes. So basically he said, here's mud in your eye. You know? So he spit on the ground, made some little mud cakes, put them on this guy's eyes. Now, I know this to be a fact because my grandmama told me this. Spit has medicinal purposes. Okay? That's why, like, when I get cut, I lick my finger and hold it on there. Seems to work for me. I don't know. You know? So, saliva, that's that fancy word for it, you know, has always thought that to have medicinal power. But for the Jews, in their legalistic thinking, they were suspicious of anybody who did anything with saliva because it sort of smacked of the magical arts and, you know, the mumbo jumbo and all that kind of thing. But it's very important, and we got to notice something here. Really, the only reason Jesus spit was so he could make some mud. You just got to get that through your head. You know, that's the only reason he made spit was so he could make some mud. So he makes these little mud pies and puts them on this guy's eyes. Now remember, this guy has never seen before in his life. He doesn't have a clue who's putting his hands on him. He don't have a clue what's stuck on his eyes. He don't know nothing. All he knows is some guy talking to him and he feels this warm stuff on his face now and his eyes are kind of caked up. And so Jesus tells him, verse 7, says, go, Jesus said, wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. So he left, he being the blind man, left, washed, and came back seeing. Came back seeing. Now the pool of Siloam was built by Hezekiah, who was king of Israel. And back then they used to have these, whenever the warriors would want to capture a town, they would build a siege wall around the town and they would cut off all the supply of food and water and all that kind of stuff. Well, Hezekiah built a tunnel from a pool outside the gate, the spring of Gihon in the Kidron Valley. He built a tunnel from that spring inside the gates of Jerusalem, and that water came in and it created this pool of Siloam. Okay, it was inside the walls. And so it was originally built so that if there was a siege, the people inside the city could still get, you know, good running water. Now, imagine that scene. Just get this scene in your head. You're blind, never been able to see a day in your life, and some guy walks up and puts warm mud on your eyes. And you don't even know what mud is. You don't even know what it's on there. You don't even know what's on your eyes. And then this voice tells you, go wash in the pool of Siloam. Okay? Think about this now. For a blind person to get from where they were to the pool of Siloam, it's not like walking from here to the elementary room up there. It went down a huge flight of steps. It went through, and they were just, you know, remember I said the festival was just leaving, so there were thousands of people going down that thing. So this blind guy is by himself trying to find his way down to this pool of Siloam. Okay? Make sure you get that in your head. All right? rock steps at the very end, and the rock steps lead right down to the water's edge. And so, amazingly, the guy did it. He got up and went through all of that, fought the crowds, everything, probably stumbled and rolled down the steps two or three times, finally found the water, washed. You know, I don't know. I've thought about this. I don't know. Maybe he'd heard Jesus was around and he thought, okay, this is Jesus, so something good's going to happen. Or maybe he just felt this guy putting stuff on his eyes and he felt it kind of hardening up. He thought, I better go wash this off, you know, because something's going to happen. Or maybe there was this authority or this love or compassion or something in Jesus' voice that just he was compelled to obey. You know, that's the voice of Jesus. When you hear Jesus, there's a compassion there and there's an authority there and there is a love for you there and you're just compelled to obey. You're just compelled to obey. So we don't know. But what we do know is this. He went, he obeyed, and he stepped out on faith. And for him, stepping out on faith was major because he couldn't see a lick. Do you see like a thread weaving through all of these things, stepping out on faith? Some of us like to sit on our holy haunches and do nothing. And wait on Jesus. All right, Jesus, I'll be here, man. When you get ready to show up, I'll be here. And Jesus shows up and says, you do something, you're like, you know, I'm kind of comfortable here, Jesus. I kind of like it where I am. Don't make me, huh? What? You going to make me do what? But Jesus's, and hear this, this is critical. Jesus' amazing power made this guy see. It had nothing to do with Jesus' spit, nothing to do with the mud, nothing to do with the pool of Siloam. Jesus could have done it right there, boom. It was the power of Jesus that healed this guy, that opened his eyes. And ladies and gentlemen, it is the power of Jesus that is going to open your eyes and heal you. That's what it's going to be. It's not going to be some emotional mumbo jumbo. It's not going to be some manipulative something another. It's the power of Jesus that's going to open your eyes. It's the power. This guy could do nothing to make himself see. And listen, you as a blinded, lost sinner can do nothing to make yourself see. Only the power of Jesus. The only thing that's going to make you see, and the only thing that makes this guy see, is the following the words of Jesus. Now, I want you to think about this, too. We were talking, Megan and I were talking back in the back there. Megan works for an ophthalmologist. You got to understand something. This is not like Jesus, like, took the scales off the guy's eyes. Okay? This is not like he healed a cornea or he did a, you know, like, I don't even know about your eyes. I don't know how they work. I just trust that they do. Okay, but whatever's in there, like your cornea, your retina and all that kind of stuff, I don't know. You know, it wasn't like he fixed that. Do you realize this guy was born blind? There's a thing called the synaptic pathway from your brain to your eye that did not exist. And Megan was saying it is physically impossible to recreate a synaptic pathway. If you're human. Now, if you're the creator of the universe who makes people out of mud and ribs, you can make a synaptic pathway. Cindy and I had the privilege yesterday, remember little Evangeline that we've been praying for? If you don't know the story of Evangeline, Evangeline was born with a very rare genetic disorder. She was not supposed to live 3 hours. Well, first of all, she's 6 months old. She stayed in the hospital for a month. Then the hospital sent her home just simply so her siblings could meet her before she died. Okay? Half her brain was not there. Her eyes, she had just very little pea-sized eyeballs. Okay? Was never going to see. Nothing. Nothing they could do for her. Okay? Well, first of all, that half her brain grew. Booyah! And then if you remember a few weeks ago, we were praying because without her eyes being a certain, her eyeballs being a certain size, she could not have the surgery she needed to correct her little eyes. So they went, what did she say yesterday, five times? They went five times to the eye guy and went four times. And on the fourth time, the guy said, nothing I can do. We're not able to do the surgery, nothing. She said, please just measure them one more time. Just measure them one more time. So they went back the next day, and she said the guy measured them. And y'all might remember, we were praying specifically for her eyes to grow. And I'm not saying we did this. God did this, okay? But there were a lot of people praying. She said he measured them. Measured them again. And sat down and typed his computer. And she said, we were over there going, the doc turns around and says, I don't have a clue, but her eyes are big enough. Let's schedule the surgery. Bam! That is God. Listen, you can't tell. That ain't nothing medical happened there. That is the power of God pouring into that young girl's life. Cindy held her yesterday, and when I saw Cindy hold, yesterday was the first day little Evangeline had been out in public without going to the doctor to a public event in her whole life. Cindy held her, and I couldn't do anything but cry, and all I looked at them little toes, and I just watched her, and she's got her little feeding tube in, all this stuff. And I just kept saying, you're a miracle, you're a miracle, you're a miracle, you're a miracle. And her mom said, she's a miracle. I said, I know, she's a miracle. God, listen, God is in the miracle working business. Maybe half of your brain ain't there. I've been told I got a lot, you know, God wants to redo you. wait, whoa now. But God can rebuild that part of your brain, Andy. y'all didn't see that, but I saw that down here on the front. little word from the peanut gallery there. But God can listen, maybe the world's telling you your sight is too limited. But man, God can open your eyes and he can show you everything he wants to show you. Maybe the world is telling you you ain't even supposed to be here. And God just loves it. I love that last thing. Sometimes God shows up and sometimes he shows off. God is showing off with little Evangeline. And I love every second of it. And that's what he's doing here. That's exactly what he's doing here. Listen to what Mark Batterson says. The healing miracle wasn't as simple as correcting an astigmatism, healing a corneal scar, or removing a cataract. Jesus hardwires this blind man's brain to create a synaptic pathway that did not exist. Now, if Jesus can do that, he can get you out of your financial mess. If Jesus can do that, he can get you out of your relational mess. If Jesus can do that, he can get you out of whatever mess you got yourself in. If you let him. And if you take a step of faith. And if you listen to him. Now, as with always, any of you watch Saturday Night Live or used to? Okay, you don't have to be afraid. I'm the preacher. I'm telling you, I do. You know, I listen to John Boy and Billy and watch Saturday Night Live, and I'm proud of it. You know, but there was a woman on there, a sketch called Debbie Downer. It didn't matter what was happening. It was all great. Debbie Downer always had some, you know who I'm talking about, because you know there's a Debbie Downer in your office. There's a Debbie Downer in your life. You know that. So there's a Debbie Downer in everything. So here we meet the Debbie Downers. This is the third relationship here. Okay, the neighbors, this is the neighbors and the blind man. And I call this the speculation. Okay, the speculation. Look at their confusion, verses 8 and 9. They want to know, is this the same guy? What's going on here? So his neighbors, this is reading from Scripture, his neighbors and those who formerly had seen him as a beggar said, isn't this the guy who sat begging? And some said, yes, he's the one. No, others were saying, he just looks like him. Okay? Naturally, people want to see what's going on here. They want to see what caused such a miracle. But here's the thing. Because the guy had never seen and he never saw Jesus, he didn't know who did it. He just knew his name was Jesus, and he didn't know what had happened. So the neighbors didn't know what to make of this thing. They're just all up in the air. Well, you know, maybe it was this, maybe it was that, maybe it was this. You know, I hope to goodness well-meaning people don't sit around Evangeline's mom and daddy and say, well, maybe it was this, maybe it was that, maybe it was this. It was God, period. End of story. So they were totally confused. But I love the way this guy, the guy who was blind, clarifies the situation for everybody who could see. Look at verse 9, the second half of 9 through 11. He says, I'm the guy. He kept saying, I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the one. Therefore they ask him, then how were your eyes opened? He said, the man called Jesus made mud, spread on my eyes, and told me to go to Siloam and wash. When I did, I washed and I received my sight. The former blind guy, who now could see better than all of his neighbors, was saying, I don't have a clue how this happened. Don't ask me. All I know is Jesus told me to do something. I did it, and I was healed. What a perfect test. You realize when you share your story, your testimony, your faith story, that's all you're doing. You're doing exactly what this guy said. I ain't got a clue. I was blind. I met this Jesus guy. Now I can see. You know? Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. That's true. That is true. And you don't, listen, man, you don't have to know systematic theology. I don't know it. I got six big old books back there. Each one of them is about this big. And when I prepare a sermon, I pull all them things out and spread them out, and I pull stuff out of them. So I can't spell systematic theology. Okay? But that don't matter. I don't have to know that to sit with a guy at Burger King down here and say, man, tell me about your life. He don't want to know if I know about post, pre, or millennial, amillennial, jasmophoria and all this kind of stuff, whatever it is. You know, he don't care. He said he just wants to know some white man sitting there talking to him about his life because his life stinks right now. That's what we need to do, folks. We listen to Jesus. We just tell him who Jesus is. I'm going to read a pretty good section of a paragraph from Mark Batterson because it's just so important. I'd be amiss if I left it out. But listen to this. This is the point here. Scripture is explicit when it comes to the sequence of this miracle. It says, he came back seeing. Now listen, if he hadn't taken this step of faith and gone to the pool of Siloam, I don't think the miracle would have happened. Okay. And that's one secret to experiencing the miraculous. Most miracles require an act of blind obedience. Now listen, this is Mark Batterson still going. You cannot manufacture miracles, but you can wash in the pool of Siloam. One step of obedience can open your eyes. One step of obedience can reverse the curse. One step of obedience can begin a new chapter in your life. Now listen to the rest of the paragraph. Ophthalmologists would call this man's condition irreversible. The natural window of opportunity had closed, just like for a little Evangeline. Her window of opportunity was closing, where she was either going to have surgery or she was never, ever going to see. Okay? The natural window of opportunity had closed, but that's when God performed some of his greatest miracles. Do you ever feel like you've missed your window of opportunity? Now listen, maybe you've lost count of how many specialists you've gone to or how many treatments you've taken. Maybe your last marriage ended in divorce and you're not sure if you can love someone, let alone trust somebody anymore. Or maybe repeated mistakes seem to have sabotaged whatever integrity you had. Or maybe social stigma has ostracized you from your friends and family. Or maybe you feel so sexually broken that you aren't even sure what healthy sexuality looks like or feels like anymore. Now, what I want you to understand, and Mark Batterson's clear here, those are not hypothetical situations. Okay? Those are real people that Jesus healed. The woman with the issue of blood, the woman at the well, the tax collector, the leper, and the woman caught in adultery. Batterson goes on to say, I don't know your specific circumstances, but I do know that God can create a new synaptic pathway or repair an old one. He is the God of second chances and third and fourth and thousands. It's never too little. It's never too late. When Jesus gets involved, never say never. You realize that Jesus performed more miracles relating to sight and than any other miracle in the Bible. And the reason is he came to clear the sight of those who have been blinded to the things of God. We are spiritually blind. No light perception? Wow. Thank you, Max. No light perception. So, before we meet Jesus, we have no light perception. But Jesus is the light of the world. Now, the choice is yours. Do you want to go through life with no light perception? Or do you want to see and really see? Thank you for that. Thank you for that. Which brings me to the point here. The whole irony of this whole thing is that if you go on and read the rest of the chapter, the Pharisees, the religious guys, jumped on the bandwagon and they started just accusing this guy of all kinds of stuff and running him down the rail and doing everything they could do. And he finally said, look, I ain't got a clue. And he shuts them up by saying, I couldn't see, now I can see. Jesus, I don't know. Okay? I don't know. So the thing is this. Mark Batterson says, faith isn't just a way of living. Faith is also a way of seeing. The old adage is true. Seeing is believing, but the opposite is even truer. Believing is seeing. So have you spent your whole life looking for something you can believe? Or have you spent your life, maybe you're ready to say, I don't have to see it anymore. I can believe it, then I can see it. Some of you waiting on God to do this crazy thing in your life, and God is waiting on you, and God's saying, it's time. It's time. I don't know what God's telling you today, but listen, man, I know, I just want to ask you, who are you in this story? Are you those self-righteous, legalistic disciples who think they're entitled to everything because they've been paying penance to God? Or maybe you're this blind guy that has no light perception. No light perception. Maybe you're this blind guy after he received his light perception. Maybe you're in the midst of struggle. Maybe you're a believer, but you're struggling through many circumstances and people are telling you, you caused this or you did that or you did that. Guys, it's time to quit laying blame on stuff and just say, it's done. I'm ready to step up from it. I'm no longer going to make excuses. I'm going to make history. And do it. Take that step of faith. Do what God's telling you to do today, whatever that is. I don't know what it is. But listen, I'm just going to tell you, if you need prayer, one of the things we'd love to do here is pray for you. Okay, Cindy will be over there. Cynthia's right here. Jim and Eddie are right over there. Daryl's right there in the back. Some of our other elders, Kevin knows, are around. Let us pray for you. Let us pray for you. Whether it's financial, relational, spiritual, health-wise, whatever it is, let us pray for you. Some of you might just want to say, I just need Jesus. I'm blind as a bat. And I'm tired of it. I want to see, and I want to see with Jesus' eyes. You know, a friend of mine wrote a song. It's called Your First Sight. It takes a little liberty with this passage, but it's very important. He says, let your first sight be Jesus. Because chances are really good, the first thing this guy saw when he opened his eyes was the face of Jesus. Guys, Jesus is waiting. Jesus is waiting. Don't run from Him. Run to Him. Let's stand. Father, we praise You, Lord. Thank You that You're the healer. Thank You that You care about evangelize. Thank you that you care about this guy by the pool. Thank you that, Lord, that we don't have to worry about whether it's our sin or somebody else's sin that caused our trouble. All we know, we're not even going to be worried anymore, God, about what caused our trouble. What we're going to be concerned is the outcome and allowing you to take control. So, Lord, whatever is on people's hearts today, give them the courage to make a move, that step of faith today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's sing.